What is the number one thing that keeps people from investing in real estate? You know what they're thinking? I'm gonna buy a house and I'm gonna get that nightmare tenant. They're gonna destroy the house and this is gonna be the worst choice I ever made. And yet, 90% of all millionaires make it in the game of real estate. So today I'm gonna share with you five strategies. These are pro tips on how you invest in real estate, but never have to experience the nightmare of a horrible tenant. Today we're talking about five ways to avoid awful, horrible, nasty, rotten tenants. Because when you buy one of these sweet little things and you rent it out, the last thing you want to do is lose tens of thousands of dollars on what we call a professional renter. This is someone that knows the laws. They're literally trying to move into your house. They're never going to pay you. They will become your biggest nightmare and they're here to take advantage of you. So there's got to be a way to avoid that. And take it from the guy that's transacted $2 billion in real estate. I've done 6,500 transactions. I got a slew of doors. And I'll tell you, there are tips, there are tricks that you can use to protect yourself. And today I'm going to be sharing five in particular, and at the end, a bonus, one of my favorite strategies to ensure that you never have to deal with that if you can avoid it. Over the years, I've mastered the game of buying a particular kind of single-family home, and my intention is always the same. The goal and focus is to see if you can get it to produce in 3 to 5 years $100,000 of profit. And I'm gonna tell you along the way, I've learned some tips and tricks that determines whether you make a little bit of money or whether you get to make all of the money. And a lot of it does come down to who are you gonna put into that house? Because I do remember what it was like on one of the first properties that I bought when I had a tenant that just wouldn't pay the rent. And then I tried to collect the rent and then they always had a story and, well, I lost my job and then I had a biking accident and my daughter was in the hospital. And because I was so new to the game, I kept getting caught up in these emotional stories, but feeling frustrated, like, I feel bad for you, but I'm your most important bill and you ain't paying it. And it got me really, really worried of whether this was ever gonna turn out. Now, I'm gonna fast forward to the end of the story. I sold that house years later and I made $130,000. And that's when I got it. If you get the right tenant or even have a problem tenant, but hold the home long enough, eventually you're gonna sell it and you're gonna make a really great profit. The question is, can you eliminate some of the nasty heartache along the way? This family was not able to do that because they got some squatters on their property. This is Nitin Bajaj and his family, Indian immigrants who bought a fourplex to offset the cost of living in LA. And during 2021, they had nightmare tenants who didn't pay for months. Then suddenly they stole everything. They left the house. No one wants to be in that position. But can you really stop it from happening? With the five tips I'm gonna give you, I think you can mitigate it as much as possible and keep yourself as safe as possible. And if you do experience occasionally something nasty, you're profitable enough overall that it's going to be okay. Let me share these tips with you right now. Not knowing who you're dealing with is always a recipe for disaster. So there has to be a way for you to do a handful of things that can vet the possible tenant to make sure that you get a good one. Here's the very first tip. Always screen your tenants. There's people that say they're gonna do this, but guess what? When they're novices, they actually don't do it. I'm gonna give you some really cool pro tips right here. Always check into your tenant's financial past, including a credit history check, employment status, and rental history. There are plenty of services to help with this, including First Advantage, eRenter, VeriFirst, and frankly, you're gonna find several others. All you had to do is Google it. And the important part is that you pay the really small fee, you do the check before you actually sign the deal, just to make sure that they have a clear and free past that you'd be proud to host in your house. People always assume that if you're gonna invest in real estate, that you have to do all the work by yourself. That is 100% not true. There's a reason why property managers actually exist, and you're right. They do take their cut. They can take 8 or 10 or 12% of the gross rents that they collect. The question is, could it be worth it? Check this out. Property management is a lot more than just fixing leaky pipes and collecting checks. An experienced property manager can shorten vacancy periods, act as the point of contact for renters, monitor the state of your rental, and even screen tenants. So if you're like, Kris, I would get into real estate, but I don't want to deal with tenants, then this second tip is 1,000,000% for you. Please don't try to become something you're not. Please don't play property manager if you've got a big heart like me and you're like, ah, I know I'm not going to be the bulldog. I know I'm not going to stick the contract to them. I know that I'm not going to tell them to fulfill it to the letter of the law. And if that's you, there's a reason why these people exist and they're probably a good idea for you. And I'm gonna tell you something right now. I would rather pay these guys to manage to have it done the right way as opposed to me doing it, keeping all the money, but creating so much mental burnout and anxiety and worry that I'm gonna become a don't wanter, I'm gonna liquidate the property and I'm gonna get out because I took on a role, I put on a hat that I was not meant to wear. Kris, for your third tip, I'm curious. Is there a certain amount of money that a tenant should make at a job that becomes the threshold, the line of demarcation for them being more financially responsible? Like you can probably imagine that when someone makes $30,000 a year, they tend to be less responsible than someone that makes $300,000 a year. So where is that magic cutoff? Well, you're looking at it right here. This is $60,000. And here's the secret. When your tenants earn at least $60,000 a year, problems just magically vanish and go away. And by the way, this is my private rule. This is based on my experience that I've learned on thousands of homes. Higher income is highly correlated with lower rates of property damage. There's also a liability concern involved as only 25% of tenants who make less than $30,000 a year have renter's insurance, whereas nearly 70% of tenants who make around $75,000 a year have renter's insurance. In other words, they take care of things. They take the shoes off when they enter the home. They treat it more like, hey, this is our home. Let's take some pride in this dwelling, whether we own it or not. We're gonna have friends over. People are gonna come in and out and we wanna take care of our crap. Bottom line is the more money people make, the more they take care of the crap. And the less they make, the less they value crap. So if you want your crap to be taken care of, then you need people in that house that make at least this amount of money. Yep, that's a winner.
Kris, what are you doing?
Oh, I'm going shopping for tenants right now. So you see this parking lot? My fourth tip is if you actually want to know whether a tenant's going to take care of your house, can they take care of their car? Check this out. So if you look in here, this is awful rude of me, but I see unfinished drink containers, stuff lying around everywhere. There's a blanket. There's McDonald's bag right over here. Come check it out. Like they've just literally got garbage everywhere in here. I'm going to tell you right now, I don't care how much money this person makes. They are not going to take care of your house. They're going to trash your house. They're going to put holes in it. They're going to beat it up. And you're going to have to spend thousands of dollars rehabbing it on its way back to putting your next tenant in it. What's the take home lesson? If you're the property manager on your own properties, make sure that you walk by their car and you see them out for the final interview. All right, the fifth and final tip before I get to my special bonus is to actually reach out and call references. If you have a fear of calling strangers, now is definitely a good time to set that aside. Past references are the biggest asset you have as a landlord to make sure potential tenants will pay rent on time and treat your property well. And I'm telling you right now, if you do all five of these tips, you are golden. You're doing everything that you can to protect yourself. You're learning from a guy that has done this thousands of times. And now you're leveraging all of my pro tips all at once, all together. But I got a special secret for you. And this is the one that makes me the most money. There's a lot of people that wanted to know how I became financially free so fast from investing in real estate. Because when I built my original portfolio, I wasn't doing straight rentals. I was doing something else. It was called a lease option or like a rent to own. And essentially a lease option or rent to own contract sets aside a portion of each rent payment towards the eventual purchase price of a house. This arrangement incentivizes the tenant to pay on time, keep the property in good condition. Listen, they're doing all the repairs. They're taking care of the property. They usually give you a $3,000, $5,000, $7,000, $10,000 deposit upfront just to have the right to have that option available to them. And I wrote this book, The Straight Path to Real Estate Wealth, basically step-by-step showing how I make twice as much money on a lease option than a typical rental. So imagine for a moment that the person that you put or the family that you put into the home is no longer a renter. They're like, hey, you're doing something really cool. We're eventually going to buy this house. So we're gonna take care of it. We're gonna do all the upkeep. We're gonna manage everything. And we're gonna pay a premium on rent. Now, if that sounds good to you, you definitely wanna click the link below and grab a free copy of this because it is a step-by-step manual for how I made my first $1.6 million and the system I started with less than $3,000 in the bank, and it's completely copycattable. As in, click the link below, cover the shipping and handling, the book itself, full color, everything, I'm gonna send out to you, and it will include everything that you need to be able to successfully leverage this strategy to make twice as much money than a straight rental. I made another video for you, and it's right here, and if you click the link, let me show you and break down exactly what is a lease option and why does it pay twice as much money compared to an investor just doing a straight rental? Well, all of that's about to become crystal clear right here.